Yes, I'll again just explain what conjecture zero is and what this L concentration conjecture is. So, say you have a circuit D of this kind. So, it has the constant term, say 1, 0, 1, and then we have something like this. Okay, and then say we have 2, 2, 0, 2. So if L is equal to 3, then what? So L concentration in D, this phrase simply means that if you look at the monomials in this circuit over the Hadamard algebra, which is just F to the 4, right? So in this case, H4F is just HKF is just H4F, which is simply F to the 4 vector space with Hadamard product. And D is a polynomial over that algebra. So when we say D is L concentrated, we mean that if you look at those monomials whose support is 2 or below, or if you look at monomials which have support 3 or more, then their coefficients are in the span of those monomials' coefficients whose support is 2 or less. Okay, so in this case, 2 or less would mean this coefficient, this coefficient, this coefficient, and there is only one monomial which support 3 or more, which is this coefficient, and you can say that this, you can see that this is in the span of these three. Right? So for example, if you add these two, you will get that. So that is what you need to check. So for L concentration, you need to check the coefficients of all the L or more support monomials and see whether their coefficients are in the lower part. So by lower part, I mean these vectors which appear with monomials that have low support. Okay, so at this point, it might not be clear why these things could ever be true. Okay, so this is of course a very tiny example of D. In general, I mean, if you look at a generic D, well, not generic, but in the worst case, of course, this will not be true. Okay, so you can easily design Ds which will not be L concentrated. And yeah, so in this talk, we think of L as something log n k. Okay, so yeah, so as I said, one very vague intuition is that if you look at these vectors as randomly chosen, okay, so every coordinate is chosen just randomly from a big enough field. Then, of course, as soon as you pick any k vectors, I mean, they will be independent with high probability. Okay, so if the low support monomials are more than k, then I mean, randomly picking the coefficients, they will, of course, every random d will be L concentrated. Okay, so in the randomized or for a generic d, this is trivially true. Without even using the special structure of D. Okay, in our case, D is a product of linear polynomials. You don't even need that information. So any generic D is actually L concentrated for L something like log K. Okay, so generic Ds obviously have this property, but in the worst case, it is far from trivial. So it is not clear. Well, in the worst case, I mean you whether by shifting the variables of a bad D, you can make it good. Okay, this is not clear. And there, of course, we would have to ultimately, in every design, we will have to use the fact that D is of this special kind, that D is a product of linear polynomials. You cannot hope to prove such a thing. In fact, such a thing is false for general Ds. Ds which are just general polynomials, there, no matter how you shift, इफ इट्स एन एफिशिएंट शिफ्ट यू कैन नॉट मेक इट एल कॉन्सेंट्रेटेड. सो फॉर जनरल पॉलिनोमियल्स दिस इज ऑफ कोर्स फॉल्स, बट फॉर जेनेरिक पॉलिनोमियल्स इट इज ट्रू. सो एनी क्वेश्चंस अबाउट द डेफिनेशन और द कंजेक्चर? इज देर एनी क्वेश्चन एट ऑल हियर? ओके या सो द मॉडिफाइड कंजेक्चर इज more flexible, so it says that well d may be bad but after an efficient shift or a sub exponential time shift the d prime which you will get that will be good. So there when you will look at the low support coefficients they will already have enough rank, so picking higher support coefficients will not actually grow the span. And what this means for PIT is that if you look at the dot product with any vector C transpose, so C transpose dot D or D prime. So this originally we had circuit C, we shifted it and the shift gave us C prime. So we have actually a black box for C prime as well, right? And in the abstract world, we had this abstract circuit D, which of course we cannot access. I mean, we only have access with the dot product. We don't have access to D. Direct access to D is we don't have. But this abstract D, its shifted version is D prime. And if this D prime is L concentrated, then it only means that C prime is non-zero if and only if C prime has a non-zero uncancelled low support monomial. Okay, and if C prime, so then the question of PIT just boils down to checking what are the coefficients of L support monomials, L or below. Okay, and that believe me is easy. So when L is very small like log, then so you can do it in time n to the l. Okay, it's basically I mean one trivial algorithm is that you just plug in all the variables to be zeros except some l that you plug in one. Okay, so you plug in, you use such evaluations and these evaluations will be enough to verify that there is a low support uncancelled monomial in C prime. Okay, hence PIT. So we'll not talk about PIT, we'll now on just talk about rank concentration because it suffices. And in particular we are interested in this this conjecture, the L concentration conjecture. So yeah, so what I will do next is show that as a range check, we want to check whether what happens when we shift it by a random point. After shifting by a random point, is D prime L concentrated? So that we will show is true. Okay, so we claim that a random shift makes D, so a random efficient shift makes D L concentrated for that L. Okay, so this may not be true. This is not true if L is smaller than this. Okay, so even by a random shift, you will not be able to get concentration below this. So this log is really a threshold here. Anything bigger than log is fine. Okay, so to prove this, we need to study the transfer from the circuit D to D prime or the polynomial D to D prime. Yeah, so from now on, just for the sake of notation, so we don't want to get into a complicated notation, we assume that D is a multilinear circuit over the Hadamard algebra. Actually, the proof of this claim will not even require this structure. Okay, the proof will work if for any D. For any D, the random shift will give you that amount of concentration. But say we stick with this and we in addition assume that it's multilinear just for a simplified notation. Okay, so let us call this jth factor linear polynomial Lj, L sub j. Let us apply the formal shift. So the formal shift is simply shift by formal variables, new variables t1 to tn. Okay, so this simply means xi is sent to xi plus ti. Okay, so x1 plus t1, x2 plus t2, dot dot xn plus tn. So this is at which d is evaluated, that we define as d prime. And what is happening inside? Well, the inside, in this case, you see that the coefficients of x1 to xn remain the same, but it's only in the constant term where all the action happens. So this basically, this thing is evaluated at t1 to tn, and that is what you get as the new constant term in every factor. Okay, so you already see here that something has shifted towards constant, and overall we expect only good things in the low support. So the way we will show this is we will study. So yeah, so this study is all about how the coefficients are related. Okay, so the dependencies between the coefficients. L concentration says that higher support coefficients are dependent on the low support ones. That may not be true. If that was not true in the original circuit D, still there were many, many dependencies. Okay, in every D, since there are many, many coefficients, or as long as you have more than k coefficients, immediately there is some dependency. Because if you have, simply because if you have k plus 1 vectors of dimension below k, there is always a dependency. So we want to study all the dependencies, original dependencies of D, and how they are getting transformed after the shift. Again, we want to show that after the shift, the dependencies start moving towards the, start using the low support coefficients. So we want to study F dependencies of the coefficients of D and the change. Okay, so we need a name for all the coefficients. So that is Z, capital Z, let it be the coefficients matrix. So it has basically columns, and every column simply, so the Sth column is simply the coefficient of x sub s in D. Okay, so there are 2 to the n columns. For the corresponding column, you simply pick the coefficient in D, that coefficient in D. So it's a k cross 2 to the n dimensional matrix. And the relationships between these coefficients, that we call, that we collect again as columns in this matrix called the null vectors matrix. Okay, so these are the original coefficients and these are the null vectors. These are the dependencies. So Z times V basically means, if since V is a column vector, this is a combination of the columns of Z, which are then the coefficients, and that is zero. So it's a dependency of the coefficients. So each V is a null vector in that sense. Okay, so we have Z and NZ. Yeah, so Z is k cross 2 to the n, and the null space of Z is then how big? Well, so it has many, many rows, because V is, so it has 2 to the n rows, and how many columns? Well, okay, so the columns are, we will pick the columns. I mean, this is, let's say we pick, see, there are 2 to the n vectors. Each vector is simply k dimensional. So the null space dimension is at least the difference of 2 to the n minus and k, right? So it is at least this. So this is roughly a square matrix. slightly fewer columns than rows. Okay, so yeah, that's just the general picture about these matrices. So I of course did not write that, but I mean when I say null vectors matrix, I want to only consider independent null vectors. I don't want to consider dependencies which are already dependent. So I want to consider independent dependencies, which means the null vectors are all, we pick a basis of the null vectors or null space, okay, and make them as columns. Yeah, so just saying that again, Z has its rows respectively columns indexed by, so rows are indexed by set 1 to k, and the columns are indexed by subsets of 2 to the, well, subsets of n, with the interpretation that a subset simply corresponds to a monomial in the multilinear model, okay, natural correspondence. And hence NZ, its rows are also indexed by subsets of N. Columns we don't care, columns are as many as are the dependencies. Okay, so we studied the relationship between the null space of Z and null space of Z prime. So what is Z prime? Well, Z prime are now the coefficients of D prime. Okay, so we had Z the coefficients before, and after the shift we have potentially new coefficients, and they are, look at the corresponding coefficient matrix, let's call it Z prime, and similarly we have the null space, null vectors matrix NZ prime. So there are two ways to do this study. You can either study how the Z's were transformed, or you can study how the null space was transformed. Remember the transformation. The transformation is a shift. That's an invertible transformation. Okay, so these two pictures are isomorphic. I mean, in all ways, because you can repeat the shift with the negative shift, and you will come back from Z prime to Z. So there is absolutely no information loss when you apply a shift, any shift, not just by formal variables, but shift in general is an invertible transformation. Yeah, so you can study any of these transformations. So since we were interested in dependencies, we actually studied this second transformation. After our work, Mike Ramprasad and Amir studied, they took the primal approach. So they only care about, they study the first transformation. How is the Z getting transformed to Z prime? And that transformation, they discover extractor like properties in that transformation. This is how they phrase it. But we'll stay with the null space transformation study. Why is that? Well, because we believe that the null space has very strong symmetry properties when these are special. I mean, by special, I mean simply this. So when D is not a general polynomial, but it is a polynomial of this kind, it is a product of linear polynomials. And we are of course assuming that D is multilinear. In that case, there is a strong symmetry in the null vectors matrix. So yeah, I won't go into it, but for example, by symmetry, I mean that if you take a null vector, any column in this NZ, by simply permuting the coordinates in the column, you get exponentially many other columns in the null in this matrix NZ. Okay, so this is such a strong symmetry, it is almost never true when you pick a general polynomial D. Okay, so this actually follows from this this kind of a D. So null space has a symmetry property, and we hope that in the future that symmetry property will be helpful. Z, on the other hand, has no property. I mean, Z is, of course, in this case, Z also has a property, but it is hard to analyze because it is not in terms of permutations. It is something else. So, yeah, that's the very vague reason why I will keep focusing on the null space and how it changes. Okay, so yeah, to study the transformation, now since this is a huge matrix, it's an exponential size matrix, the transformation is also exponential by exponential. Okay, so it's a pretty big transformation which is acting on the null space. And I want to study that. Okay, so let us now write down a very simple equation which tells us so yeah, here for various reasons I am looking at the inverse shift. So in d prime, if you shift by minus t, so xi is sent to xi minus ti, if you use the reverse shift, you go back to d. Okay, so look at this equation, compare the coefficients in this equation. Okay, so let us take the tth, capital tth monomial, look at its coefficient, let's call it z sub t. How is it related to the coefficients of d prime? Okay, so we are comparing x sub t monomial on both sides. So when you compare, I mean, if you just think about it for a few minutes, you will see that essentially all the supersets of t, they come together, their coefficients come together, and that combination becomes zt. Okay, so on the right hand side, the coefficient of x sub t is essentially all the coefficients in d prime weighted with this reverse shift and summed. Is this too confusing or? Yeah, so that's all. The only point is that it sums over the supersets. Yeah, so d prime had the z primes as coefficients. D prime x minus t, when you look at that, will have all the higher coefficients, they will come and get added to the coefficient of x sub t. And when you compare, you get that z sub t is there. Yeah, and this minus t sub s notation simply refers to the signed monomial. So we are just multiplying minus t i's, whichever i's appear in s. Okay, so there is this weighted contribution because of t1 is not 1 but formal variable. Okay, so this is true for every subset t. You look at all these equations, okay, and that will give you what we call one of the transfer equations. So it will, so we basically, the tth column here, which is z sub t, the tth column, that is essentially the linear combinations of all the sth columns here with the appropriate weight. Okay, so the appropriate weight we factor into three parts. M here is simply a Boolean matrix, it's a 0-1 matrix, which just captures whether, so this is the row index s, this is the column index t, whether the column is a subset of the row index. Okay, it is 1, otherwise it is 0. So this is simply a 0-1 matrix. A and A inverse, so A is a diagonal matrix which takes care of this contribution which is coming. Okay, so this is simply A is a diagonal matrix with the diagonal sth entry as the signed monomial. Okay, so if you, so why is there A and A inverse? Well, you see here a difference S minus set difference T. So, well, S comes from here and minus T comes from here. Okay, so that we have separated into two parts, and in the middle is only a Boolean matrix, and that matrix will tell which Z prime S's come together in a non-trivial way to contribute to Z sub T. Okay, so essentially there are two matrices, A diagonal with monomials, T monomials and M a Boolean matrix. Okay, yeah, so that is the first transfer equation. It says how is Z prime transformed to Z, and okay, so what I am doing next is so remember the original conjecture. So there we were. Yeah, so this L concentration conjecture was that we want to look at D prime modulo span of the coefficients in D prime which only appear in the low support monomials, okay, spans abel D prime. So these vectors we sort of we take them for granted, okay. So the low support coefficients of D prime are taken for granted. So we only want to understand what is happening in the rest of D prime. That is what this mod is saying. So the same thing we will do here. So in this transfer equation, we really don't care about the low support coefficients of Z prime. So those columns we want to drop. And we want to see what has happened in the rest of the coefficient vectors, in the rest of the columns of Z prime, how have they transformed to Z. So we go modulo this span, it's the same span, go modulo this span. So that would mean what? That in Z prime, now we are only looking at those columns that correspond to monomials of support L or more. Okay, only the higher support columns survive, and that leads to also a shortening of this matrix A, so that the multiplication still makes sense, and also the rows of M get truncated. Okay, so now M also has fewer rows. This A inverse is fine because we did not touch the columns of M, so that is still A inverse, but these three things have changed. And it's a congruence, okay, it's not an exact equality. So okay, let me just explain a bit more about the indexing. So let me use the notation n sub greater than equal to L to denote subsets of L or more size. M sub L is it has rows. The only rows that we have kept are those indexed by this, okay, L or more support. They survive. The columns we haven't touched, so the columns are still indexed by 2 to the n, so all the monomials. And again, ML is just a submatrix of M, so it has the same property. Whatever ST, it just indicates, it's an indicator variable which it indicates whether T is a subset of S. The same property as before. AL is just suitably indexed, so AL has to multiply on the left, so it has just as many diagonal entries as the rows of ML, so it is also indexed by this, and it's the same definition. ALSS is the signed monomial, appropriate signed monomial. And Z prime, as I said, has rows we did not touch, the columns we have dropped some. So the ones that remain are indexed by n greater than equal to L. So this is the picture, and in this picture now, for any null vector of Z, for any dependency, if you multiply on the right, okay, this thing will give you zero. So if you multiply by all these independent null vectors, the whole null vectors matrix, you get this equal to congruent to zero modulo the restricted span sub L. Okay, so this we call the transfer equation. Yeah, so we had actually everything here was at, oh, this is the third transfer equation. This might seem very mysterious, but one explanation is that what this is expressing is that if you take any null vector of Z, any dependency of the original coefficients, if you look at this part, okay, you are getting a dependency of Z prime. So that is the interpretation. This equation says modulo. We could have also done this without going modulo, but ultimately, what we are interested in is we want to remove all those. We want to study the part which is only high support. So we have to go on modulo. And the interpretation of this part is that. Okay, so I can use what Jaikumar suggested. So this part is the transformation of nz into nz prime. Okay, so this is the change in the dependencies. The dependencies of z, they change to dependencies of z prime, and actually even more here, so they actually change into the dependencies of Z prime L modulo the span. Is this transfer equation clear? What it is saying? So it is simply the studying this change. And yeah, so what is the source of L concentration? The source of L concentration is, or when will we have L concentration? So, from all these linear dependencies, we want to deduce that Z prime L is equal to 0. Okay, if we could deduce that Z prime L is congruent to 0 modulo this span, then that is exactly the L concentration conjecture. Because, well, Z prime L are those coefficients which were appearing in higher support of D prime, and Z prime L congruent to 0 would simply mean that every such vector is in the low, it is in the span sub L. That is exactly L concentration conjecture. So that is exactly the property which we want. So I mean, the obvious way to get that from this transfer equation is that this transformation prove that it is full rank. If it is full rank, then by just picking the right columns, this you actually get an invertible matrix. So that invertible matrix you can just cancel out, and you will get from this transfer equation Z prime equal to 0. Okay, so that is the source of L concentration. So if we can show, and further, I mean, in this AL is merely a diagonal matrix where the entries are monomials. Okay, so that is trivially invertible. So forget about that. So the key thing is really to show that ML A inverse NZ, okay, this matrix product is full rank. Okay, then this whole product is full rank, and then you can cancel it out from this equation. So, yeah, what we want to study is the action of the transfer matrix. So this ML we call transfer matrix. The action of the transfer matrix on the dependencies. This is the action of this Boolean matrix on all the original dependencies. What is this action we want to understand? That would have been still fine, but we have an A inverse in the middle, which is these monomials, okay, or these exponentially many monomials in T's. So that introduces some complication, but at least in this proof it will help us. For efficiency, it's a problem. Yeah, what else? So the goal is to understand the properties of the transfer matrix M sub L. And yes, so to understand the properties of this matrix, to understand the properties of the null space and to understand their action. Okay, these three things we want to understand, and if that understanding is enough to show this its full rank nature, then we can cancel it out and we have L concentration. So is this clear? Okay. So the first part, which is properties of the transfer matrix M sub L, there is this nice proof mainly found by Arpita and Rohit that it is M sub L itself is very strongly full rank. Okay, so what we can show is that any non-trivial combination of the rows of this matrix, so it's a Boolean matrix, okay, any non-trivial combination of the rows of this matrix always has 2 to the L non-zero entries. Okay, so this is also where this lower bound of L log K enters. But this is the source. So this is the combinatorial property of the transfer matrix. And the proof is really just straightforward induction on the variables. So, I mean, if you remember, the transfer matrix was defined via so the tth column and the sth row, it's an indicator whether T is a subset of S, right? So it's simply this this indicator 0, 1 is there, and T is a subset of, so S and T are subsets of 1 to N. So simply an induction on N, and of course assuming this obvious thing that L is less than equal to N. I mean, if L is N, then there is nothing to do really. Then there is trivially L concentration. Okay, so L is of course less than equal to N. Use this and then use induction on N. And that induction will give you this property. This is a purely combinatorial question. You look at this Boolean matrix and of course the truncation is important. So remember that there are fewer rows here. So we have, these are the rows and the columns are, columns are everything, are all the monomials. But since, I mean, we have fewer rows, so we have longer vectors here, and it is a very nice combinatorially defined matrix. It has the property that any non-trivial combination of rows has many, many non-zero entries, exponential in L. No, this is over the field F, because the transfer equation is over F. Oh yeah, so it's a 0-1 matrix. The induction argument doesn't care about F. It's a good point, yes. Okay, so yeah, till this point we haven't really used any properties of B. I mean, D for all we know is just a general multilinear polynomial over the Hadamard algebra. Okay, so the transfer matrix is really just a general matrix, and it has this property. It always has this property. Yeah, so column space is something which is which might, or I mean, we expect it to be very much dependent on how D was generated, okay, the complexity of this polynomial D. So that is where all the properties of B hide. But I mean, for this random shift case, we won't need huge properties. So in this case, we simply use that no matter, I mean, it suffices to look at columns of NZ to be just of sparsity k plus 1 or below. So this is simply because any k plus 1 columns of Z are F dependent. Okay, so any k plus 1 coefficients that you take in D they will be dependent simply because, well, the vectors are of the dimension k. They have k, only k coordinates. So any k plus 1 coefficients are dependent, which means that if you look at the null space, it is just generated by columns of sparsity at most k plus 1. So it suffices to look at those kinds of null vectors. That's also, both these things are general. They do not use anything about which D. They are true for any multilinear D. And yeah, so these two lemmas can be used to analyze the formal shift. Here is a quick proof. So what do we have? Equation. So we want to show that action is full rank, right? We want to show, so we had this transfer equation. Zero congruent to Z prime sub L, A inverse, A sub L dot M sub L dot A inverse and NZ modulo the span sub L of the shifted D, the new span. Yeah, and this is the part which is key. So you want to show that M sub L A inverse dot NZ is full rank. Okay, so if this is full rank, then as I said, by just picking the right columns here, you can make this matrix invertible and then cancel it out from the transfer equation. So what we will show now, we'll actually prove that for formal T's, this is full rank. Again, we will use the combinatorial property of the transfer matrix and some trivial properties of the null space. So just use a monomial ordering on the monomials T's. Okay, so basically the entries in A's will then get ordered according to that monomial ordering. And moreover, correspondingly, the columns of Z we can now also think to be ordered. So coefficients of Z correspond to coefficients of monomials. So if monomials are ordered, then the same ordering we use to order the columns of Z. Okay. Let B be the least basis of Z. So what do I mean by basis? There are these columns of Z. Let us assume they are ordered. You start from the left and just construct a basis in the as leftmost as possible. Okay, so pick a smallest basis. I mean, since the columns in Z are just of dimension k, the basis cannot have more than k elements. Okay, so size of B is less than or equal to k. And moreover, every column which does not appear in B depends on B. B is a basis of the columns. Basis of the column span of Z. So, which means that any column outside B depends on things that appear before V, and that gives you a null vector. Okay, so this we call a good null vector. So you just focus on those. Yeah, so the picture is that, let's say Z looks like this, V1, V2, V3, V4, so on. Say V1 is a basis, V3 is a basis, V5 is a basis, and so on. Okay, so V2 depends on V1, V4 depends on V1, V3, and then maybe V6 depends on 1, 3, 5. Okay, so, and this we have ordered this. So strictly, it's a strict ordering. Yeah, so we are only interested in those null vectors that capture such a dependency on the left. and that let's say sub matrix of the null vectors matrix we denote by GZ. So notice that we haven't lost any I mean these good null vectors still span the whole null space. Okay, so we don't really miss on the null space rank, because as you can see, I mean all the dependencies will still be captured. We have just ordered them in a nice way. That's all. We do not lose anything here. And yeah, so how many dependencies are there, independent ones? Well, as I said before, there are at least 2 to the n minus k many, and let's just pick that many in GZ. Okay, we don't want any extra we don't really need any extra dependencies. So yeah, GZ, the number of columns in GZ is at least 2 to the n minus k. For our choice of L, this is much greater than this thing. Okay, the size of n greater than or equal to L, so that size is just equal to n choose L plus n choose L plus 1 plus n choose n. Okay, and 2 to the n minus k is greater than that. I mean L is log of k. Is this clear? Okay, so just observe that. And yeah, as I said, do not take any, okay, no, so not this much, but this much. So we don't need in GZ any more columns than this many. Okay, so just pick these many good null vectors, call the matrix GZ. And yeah, so in the transfer equation, we have now identified, so in this equation, we have identified some, or this matrix product, we have identified some good null vectors or good columns from NZ called GZ, and we are now only, we'll prove that ML A inverse GZ is full rank. Okay, so notice that now it's a square matrix, so we can talk about the determinant. Okay, the number of rows and columns is the same here. So what is the determinant of this matrix? Yes, it's a square matrix because again ML is of this dimension, GZ is of this dimension, and you take the matrix product. So yeah, the proof is simply apply the leading monomial operator on this determinant. Okay, simply look at what is the leading monomial in ML A inverse GZ. If you apply the leading monomial operator, you will actually see, you will see that just some columns of ML are being picked, and which are independent. Okay, so from the combinatorial properties of ML, actually it will follow immediately that those columns are. So with the what is the combinatorial property saying? It is saying that if you remove less than 2 to the L many columns of ML, ML remains full rank. Okay, so that is the interpretation which I am using here, that no matter which few columns of ML you remove, it remains full rank, and hence yeah, the leading monomial operator here will give you basically almost all of ML, which by lemma 1 will be so the determinants, I mean when you take the leading monomial operator, this determinant will actually, its zeroness or non-zeroness will boil down simply to the full rank of some columns of ML. But the columns of ML will be many, so by lemma 1 they will be independent, and hence the determinant is non-zero. So that's all. So what we have shown here is that under a formal shift, D gets L concentrated over the function field. Okay, so this is of course not much. It is just, I mean, if you so a formal also means in computer science random efficient. So what we have shown is that under a random efficient shift, any polynomial, multilinear polynomial over the Hadamard algebra becomes L concentrated. Okay, and you cannot improve this below log k. So this is for general Ds, you cannot improve this. So maybe for special, I mean, if you use properties of D, how it is generated, you can improve this. But certainly here we did not use anything about D. I mean, its circuit representation was not used. Yeah, so removing this randomness will of course require, will necessarily require using the properties of the D. Okay, that D is not a general polynomial, but it is a polynomial expressible as a product of linear polynomials. That is what I'm saying here. So we didn't use the pi sigma structure of D at all in this proof. And it is also necessary that to efficiently de-randomize this shift, we will need to use the special structure. We don't have a proof till this point. For all multilinear, we don't have a proof, but we have a proof for everything between multilinear and set multilinear. Okay, so set multilinear and things very close to multilinear, we have quasi-polynomial shifts. So I'll just try to sketch those things. Yeah, so we could work towards the concentration conjecture, which asks for efficiency and D and deterministic shift by studying simpler models. Okay, so I'll show something in this diagonal model, but any questions at this point? So what I will show, sorry, no question. So what I will show here is, this is the first model. It's a really toy model. I'll show that this is already L concentrated. It does not even require a shift. The model is as follows. Again, it is a product of linear polynomials, but the catch is that they are all the same. Okay, so, and this is not even multilinear. So it is just a power, dth power of this linear polynomial. Remember z1, z1, zn, they are all vectors. Okay, so this is called the diagonal model. It corresponds to diagonal vector circuits. I'll show that, first of all, this one we can assume without loss of generality. Okay, in general, there might have been a general vector z0 here, but by a very simple shift, you can make z0 1. By a shift and by normalization, you can assume that this is 1. So once you have 1 here, then actually this thing, this D, is already L concentrated. And this is really the first model where we showed L concentration, and then we were excited enough to look at harder models. So what is the proof here? It's quite simple. So D is already L concentrated. Simply use on these, what are the coefficients here? The coefficients here, if you just use multinomial expansion or whatever, you will get some multinomial coefficient, so some number times some products of some zi's with suitable exponents, with some at most d. Okay, so this is a general coefficient, so forget about the constant. Assume that the field is characteristic, is rational, so constants we forget. They are non-zero things. So just, so look, yeah, just look at this coefficient z sub s raised to e. S is a subset, e is a vector, exponent vector. Order them with respect to degree lexicographic order. So, which means that, so we are giving priority to degree. So first you, yes, yeah, so on all these coefficients, you, it is always the case that a lower degree comes on the left and a higher degree comes on the right. Now there are usually many, many monomials, different monomials of the same degree. You break the tie by using the lexicographic ordering. Consider x1 to be the, so z1 to be the least, zn to be the most. Okay. So use Degleck, so it's a complete ordering. And yeah, again the same trick. So let b be the least basis of the coefficients. Okay, so these we have ordered them. Well, maybe I take an example. So 1, z1, z2, z1 square, z1, z2, z2 square, z1 cube, okay, and so on. So this is the type of ordering. Look at the least basis. Okay, these are all vectors, k-dimensional. So look at the least basis. Let's say this is a basis vector, this is a basis vector, this is a basis vector, and so on. And again, basis will not be of size more than k. What we will show is that in this least basis, it is submonomial closed. Okay, so whichever monomial appears in the least basis, its submonomials also appear in the basis. Okay, it is submonomial closed, we will show. And if it is submonomial closed, then of course it cannot have high support monomials, because already L support, one L support monomial has how many submonomials? So L support monomial has 2 to the L many, at least, submonomials. Okay, and they are all independent, since we are looking at a basis. So since the basis is of size k or below, submonomial closure of B means that the basis only has log support monomials, which is same as saying there is log concentration. Okay, so it suffices to show that any submonomial of a monomial of a, yeah, of a monomial in B also is in B. So suppose not. Okay, so pick a submonomial Z S prime E prime of Z S E that is not in B, while Z S E was. So being not in B means what? Say this is our monomial and we are looking at its submonomial Z1 or Z2. Okay, we are looking at Z2. If it is not in B, then it means that there is a dependence of this on the basis vectors on the left. That dependence, if you multiply by Z1, will give you a dependence of Z1, Z2 on the previous basis elements. Okay, so this is simply the Hadamard product. Just use on the dependency Hadamard product, and that will contradict that the original monomial Z sub S to the E is in the base, was in the basis. Okay, so just this simple. So yeah, ZS prime E prime will be F dependent on some smaller monomials in B, which by Hadamard product will give you a dependence of ZSE. Okay, and it's this sequence. So that's a contradiction. So B is closed under submonomials, and hence there is already log concentration in the diagonal model. Okay, hence for the diagonal model, it is very there is a very simple n to the log n hitting set via rank concentration, because rank concentration is free here. Okay, so the rest of the talk was about generalizing these ideas to set multilinear where things are not for free. Okay, so there we will actually need some non-trivial shifts to make set multilinear rank concentrated, and then we extend it to something close to multilinear, or we basically give a gradation between the set multilinear model and the multilinear model, and depending on how far you are, you can pay the price on the shift and make things concentrated. Okay, so we call that low distance multilinear model, So till that, and the third was about invertible read once algebraic branching programs, where we actually have polynomial time hitting sets. I mean, we give polynomial constant concentration, hence polynomial time hitting sets. Okay, so invertible read once algebraic branching programs. So low distance stuff is a non-trivial generalization of set multilinear ideas, and this was something completely different, but maybe some other day. Any questions?